Hey there, everybody. Welcome back. Today we're going to look at section 1.7, which is inequalities. We're going to learn how to solve linear inequalities, which are the easiest ones. And then three-part inequalities are not really any worse than linear ones. And then quadratic and rational inequalities, which will take a little more work, but they're very doable with a little practice. So let's get started. First of all, let's look at the properties of inequalities. Let A, B, and C represent real numbers. This first one says that if A is less than B, then A plus C is less than B plus C. In other words, you can add the same thing to both sides without making the inequality false. Just like with equations, we could add the same thing to both sides and still have a true equation. Also, if A is less than B and C is positive, then we can multiply both sides by C and still the inequality will be true. If A is less than B and C is negative, then when we multiply both sides by C, we'll have to remember to flip the inequality symbol. And these same statements are true no matter what inequality symbol we have. So we can add the same thing to both sides. We can multiply both sides by the same thing as long as we're multiplying by a positive. Or if we're multiplying by a negative, we just have to remember to flip the inequality symbol over. Now, first of all, we're looking at linear inequalities. A linear inequality in one variable is one that can be written with an x term and a constant on the left and a zero on the right. The symbol is not important. Any one of our inequality symbols can be used, but you have to be able to get it down to one x term and one constant. In other words, we can't have x squared, x to the cube, square root of x, or anything with an x in the denominator. It just has to be an x term and a constant. Typically, when we solve inequalities, we write the solutions in what's called interval notation, where the smallest number in the solution is on the left and the largest number in the solution is on the right. And what's implied in interval notation is that everything in between those two numbers is part of the solution. So let's take these four inequalities here that are all compared to 7, and let's graph them on a number line, and then we'll state their interval notation. So first of all, for x is less than 7, I'm going to just mark my number line with a 7, and now I need to shade the side of the line that contains the numbers that fit this description. So I'm going to shade to the left of 7, and I put an arrow to indicate that the shading would continue forever if we had a big enough piece of paper. And now I need a symbol here that indicates whether 7 can be part of the solution or not. And if you read the inequality, it says x is less than 7. It does not say x can be equal to 7. So the symbol that we use to indicate that x cannot be equal to 7 is a round parenthesis, like that. And now for the interval notation, I state the smallest number in the interval and then the largest. Interval notation always has to go left to right. So the leftmost number is actually, we can't get there, so it's negative infinity. And the rightmost number is 7, but the 7 is not included, so I put a parenthesis to indicate that the 7 is not included. Okay, now x is greater than 7 is very similar. We'll start by putting a 7 on our number line, and we will shade to the right of 7 because that's where the greater than 7 numbers are. And then in this case as well, x cannot be equal to 7, so we put that round parenthesis to indicate that it can't be equal. And in this case, the interval notation would be from 7 to infinity. Remember, it's always left to right. Okay, now we have x is less than or equal to 7. So again, I start with the 7, and I want to shade the numbers that fit the description of being less than 7, so I shade to the left. But this time, to show that 7 can be part of the solution, that x can equal 7, I put a square bracket. And the interval notation will be from negative infinity to 7 with a bracket. And the last one, x is greater than or equal to 7, we start with the 7. We shade where the numbers are greater than 7. and we put a bracket to indicate that we have an or equal to situation. And then the interval notation goes from 7 to infinity. See, notice in every case the interval notation goes from left to right, from left to right, from left to right. Now we're about to be ready to solve our first inequality together. And you need to know that solving an inequality is exactly like solving an equation, with two exceptions. One, if you multiply or divide both sides of the inequality by a negative number, you must reverse the inequality symbol. And two, we always graph our solutions on a number line and state the solution in interval notation. Remember when we were solving equations, we would get individual answers and we would state them in curly braces. But here, our answers are not just the two numbers that we come up with or the one number that we come up with, but our answer is an interval from here to there. So we always state it with brackets or parentheses to indicate that there is an interval, an entire range of numbers that make our inequality true. And here's one for you to try by yourself. I hope you'll pause the video and do it on your own before you watch me do it. And now let's go through it together. So let's subtract 8 from both sides. That leaves us with negative 2x is less than or equal to 8. And now let's divide both sides by negative 2. When we divide both sides by negative, it forces us to have to reverse the inequality symbol. And so now we have x is greater than or equal to negative 4. And so, of course, this is an interval of numbers, so we want to graph this on a number line. Here's our negative 4. The greater than numbers are to the right of negative 4. And because of the or equal to line, we'll put a bracket on our shading. And now the interval goes from left to right. The interval goes from negative 4 to infinity. Now, I would like to take just a minute and show you how to check an inequality. There are two parts to checking an inequality solution. You need to check that negative 4 is the right number, and we also need to check that the shading is in the right direction. The way to do that is first with the negative 4, plug it in and check it the same way you would check an equation. You need to make sure that both sides are the same value. So I'm going to have negative 2 times negative 4 plus 8, and I need to make sure that that's equal to 16. So negative 2 times negative 4 would be 8, and 8 plus 8 is 16, so that looks good. And now we need to check something in the interval between negative 4 and infinity. Just pick any easy number, and what you're looking for here is not for the two sides to be the same, because they won't, but you're looking for the inequality to be true. So I choose 0. 0 would be something to the right of negative 4. And so I'm going to put negative 2 times 0 plus 8, and that's going to give me 8 is less than or equal to 16, which is true. And so that tells me that my shading is in the right direction. So again, two parts. Check the number itself as though you're checking an equation, and then check any number in the solution interval to make sure that it gives you a true inequality. Here is example 2, and this is the first one we've seen that has variables on both sides of the inequality. Now, when I solve these, I prefer to treat them the same way we treated our equations. That is, I'll look for the smallest x term and eliminate that first. So let's do that. Let's add 3x to both sides. That's going to give us 4 is less than or equal to 7 plus 5x. And now I would like to subtract 7 from both sides, and that's going to give us negative 3 is less than or equal to 5x. Now the good news here is that I've kept my x term positive, and so when I divide both sides by 5, I don't have to remember to flip the inequality symbol because I'm dividing by positive 5. But the bad news is that my x has come out on the right side, which means I'm not ready to graph yet. We only graph when x is on the left because it's backwards. If you have x on the right, it's not doing what you think it's doing. And I'll show you why in a minute. But first, let's rewrite this. If negative 3/5 is less than or equal to x, that means x is greater than or equal to negative 3/5. Now remember back to grade school when your teacher taught you about the alligator's mouth. Notice that in this first statement, the alligator's mouth is eating the x, and in the second statement, the alligator's mouth is still eating the x. So we've just turned it around, but we haven't changed its meaning. Now, the reason you need to turn it around is because when we graph, we need the x on the left. So here is negative 3/5 on my number line. And now, where are the numbers that are greater than negative 3/5? Well, they're going to be to the right, and we need the bracket because of the or equal to line. And now, think about this statement up here. This says that negative 3/5 is supposed to be less than or equal to x, or all the numbers that we shade. And notice in our graph, negative 3/5 is less than all the shaded numbers. But it's difficult to think about in this form, and it's easier to think about in this form. It's easy to say, where are the numbers that are greater than or equal to negative 3/5? Well, they are here. And so that's our graph, and now let's give our interval notation from negative 3/5 to infinity. And that's it. Now, as always, here's one for you to practice with, so I hope you'll pause the video and try it by yourself. And now let's look at it together. So here we have negative 2x minus 2 is less than or equal to 1 plus x. And what I would do is I would identify the smaller x term and I would eliminate that first. So I would add 2x to both sides. That will give me negative 2 is less than or equal to 1 plus 3x. And now I need to eliminate the constant, so I'll subtract 1 from both sides. And that's going to give me negative 3 is less than or equal to 3x. Divide both sides by 3. And now I'm dividing both sides by positive 3, so no need to turn the inequality symbol over. And that's going to give us negative 1 is less than or equal to x. Now notice again that the x is on the right side. When we never graph with x on the right, we always write it so that x is on the left. So let's restate this. If negative 1 is less than or equal to x, it means x is greater than or equal to negative 1. And remember that the wide end of the symbol will stay oriented toward the same expression. So that way the expression does not change meaning. And now here's our negative 1. Where are the numbers that are greater than or equal to negative 1? The greater than numbers are to the right. The or equal to means we'll put a bracket here. And our interval notation goes from negative 1 to infinity. And that's it. Now here is our first three-part inequality. These are also called compound inequalities because it's like we have two inequalities mashed into one problem. 5 plus 3x has to do two things at once. 5 plus 3x has to be less than 20, but also 5 plus 3x has to be greater than negative 2. Or reading from left to right, you could say negative 2 has to be less than 5 plus 3x. And 5 plus 3x has to be less than 20. So in other words, 5 plus 3x is stuck between negative 2 and 20. And all we want to do is isolate the x in the middle. So we'll start by subtracting 5 from the middle. But then if we subtract it from the middle, we have to subtract it from both end pieces as well. That's going to give us negative 7 is less than 3x, which is less than 15. And now we need to eliminate the 3 coefficient, so we divide the middle by 3, but that causes us to have to divide both ends by 3 as well. Now that's going to give us negative 7/3 is less than x, which is less than 5. So we read this, negative 7/3 is less than x, which is less than 5. But we think of it like this, x is stuck between negative 7/3 and 5. So we have two numbers on our number line. X is between them, and both of these happen to have the less than symbol, so neither one of them has the or equal to line, so they'll both have parentheses. And the solution is the interval from negative 7/3 to 5. So here is a practice one for you to try. Pause the video and give it a try on your own. And now let's go through it together. You'll want to isolate the x in the middle, which means first we get rid of the 5 by subtracting 5 from each piece. That gives us negative 10 is less than 2x, which is less than 6. And now we're going to divide each piece by 2. And that gives us negative 5 is less than x, which is less than 3. So in other words, x is between negative 5 and 3. On our number line, we want to shade in between negative 5 and 3. And neither one of these has the or equal to bar, so we'll have parentheses on both numbers here. And our interval will be from negative 5 to 3. Now I do want to point out to you, when you read this from left to right, negative 5 is less than x, which is less than 3. Negative 5 is less than all of our x's, and all of these are less than 3. So the x's are the only numbers that do both things at once. I threw in one more practice problem for us with these three-part inequalities, but just because I wanted to show you what happens with a negative coefficient. So this one will start out just like the others, and we will eliminate the constant by subtracting 3 from each piece. That gives us negative 8 is less than or equal to negative 4x, which is less than 12. Also notice this time we have two different symbols. We have an or equal to here, but not here. Okay, we divide each piece by negative 4, and that's going to cause us to have to flip those symbols over, and that's going to give us 2 is greater than or equal to x, which is greater than negative 3. Now, the thing is, well, it's odd that we have these greater than signs, but whenever that happens, you'll notice that the right number, which should be the largest, is actually the smallest. So you'll want to turn this around, restate it from right to left the way we did before. And remember, you're going to keep the inequality symbol oriented toward the same number. So notice how the point here is toward the negative 3. Then when we rewrite it, we're going to have negative 3, the point, and then the wide end. And then notice how on this one, the point is toward the x, so it stays that way. And then we have x is less than or equal to 2. So now you can see x is stuck between negative 3 and 2. And it works the same way on the number line now. So between negative 3 and 2 is here. This does not have the or equal to bar, but this one does, so it will get a bracket. And our solution is from negative 3 to 2 bracket. That's it.